A huge thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. Good morning, fellow mathematicians. Welcome back to another video. So about a month ago, at the end of the last year, I posted a video called Four Relaxing Algebra Questions or Exercise, whatever. And there I took four exercises from Brilliant's community, brilliant.org, and I put them into a video. And you guys really enjoyed this video. Hence, I'm going to take a look at four relaxing calculus problems today. And before watching the video, try them out for yourself. And when you're ready, keep watching the video for the solution. Can you figure it out? I don't think so. Yeah, I think you can figure it out actually. Like mentioned before, I found those problems over on Brilliant, today's sponsor, and definitely check them out. More information at the end of the video. A subscription there is definitely worth it. And now we are going to dive right in. So for the first problem, we can make use of a few techniques basically, but I'm going to make use of the one technique that I enjoy the most. Namely, I'm going to take a look at the asymptotic behavior of sine of x, meaning its Taylor series expansion just with the big O notation, okay? You can also use 2 times L'Hopital, I think, yeah, 2 times should do the trick, and really depends what you want to do, but I think using L'Hopital is kind of circular here, maybe, I don't know. Other than that, our answer is going to be in the form a divided by b factorial, and we are going to find out what a plus b is, okay? So keep this in mind while solving the problem. So I'm going to turn the sine of x into basically its first two members of the Taylor series expansion and then the big O notation, meaning I'm going to denote the limit as capital L. This is the limit as x approaches zero of, and now we are going to have x minus. And sine of x is the alternating series with all the odd factorials and the odd powers, basically, meaning we are going to get x at first negative and negative becomes positive, so plus x to the third power over 3 factorial, and then plus O of x to the fifth power. This big O notation just means that we are going to have leading terms that are of 5th degree or higher, basically, and all of this divided by x to the third power. And now everything is going to collapse extremely nicely. Namely, x and negative x are going to cancel out. We are going to have the additive inverse here. Then x to the third power and x to the third power are going to cancel out. Also, we are going to have that O to the O of x to the fifth power is going to turn into O of x squared, because x to the fifth power and x cubed terms are going to cancel out. Meaning this right here is just O of x squared, leaving us overall with the limit as x approaches zero. And now we are going to be left with 1 over 3 factorial and then plus O of x squared. If we let x now approach zero on those are just basically an infinite series overall, where we have x terms on each and every member, meaning if x approaches zero and if we can distribute the limit into everything, this is going to vanish, turn into zero. The limit of a constant is just a constant in itself, meaning we are going to get 1 over 3 factorial. Now this is of course something of the form a over b factorial. Now we need to find out what a plus b is, meaning from the b factorial we are just going to take an argument, namely 3, meaning our answer is 1 plus 3, giving us the successor of 3 overall, 4. And this was the first problem, and I hope you were able to figure it out for yourself. Now next up is a nested radical. We're going to have square root of 6 plus square root of 6 plus square root of 6, blah blah blah. And to kind of get this done, what we're going to do is we're going to say, okay, if everything converges, this infinitely nested square root is going to turn into some number x overall after we have the convergence. Now what you are going to see here is that those nested radicals are most of the time kind of self-similar. Meaning, if we were to cover this first square root up, you're going to notice that what we have in here, okay, just the rest, it's once again just our infinitely nested square root x. Yeah, this is just what's going to happen here if everything converges. Meaning, our question is going to turn into x is hence equal to square root of 6 plus x. And well, this is just solving a quadratic, basically. We're going to square both sides, leaving us with x squared, being hence nothing but 6 plus x. And now what we can do is we can subtract 6 and x on both sides, leaving us with x squared minus 6 minus x, hence nothing but 0. And solving a quadratic is pretty easy. Meaning what we're going to end up with are two solutions for our x, being overall, okay. Negative sign is going to turn into positive 1/2 plus minus the square root of, and now 1/4, and negative is going to become positive, so plus 6. Okay, now we are going to fill out the third, a tiny little bit. I mean, 1/4 + 6 is going to turn into 25/4 by expanding 6 with 4/4. So this is the square root of 25/4. Square root of 25/4 is going to coalesce very nicely into nothing but 5/2. Meaning our two solutions that it's going to yield are on the one hand x1 being nothing but, okay, we are going to get 1/2 + 5/2. This is 6/2 giving us 3. And the other solution that we are going to have is going to yield overall that, this right here is the end symbol. We are going to get x2 being nothing but, okay, 1/2 - 5/2 is -4/2, which is -2. But only one of those can be the solution to our problem, because I want you guys to notice something. Namely, what is the sign in front of our x, of our nested radical? It's going to be a positive sign. Meaning, the second solution with the negative sign is negligible in our case, meaning x is equal to 3 is our answer, which is kind of cool that you can express number 3 using a nested radical. Were you able to figure it out? I hope you were able to do so. Now next up is the limit as our angle phi approaches 0 of, well, we have something of the form a plus, okay, b times a minus b. This just screams, basically, for using the difference of two squares. You don't have to use the difference of two squares here, because if the limits exist, and they do because cosine and sine, they're all bounded, and in multiplication also, everything's going to converge nicely. You can also just distribute the limits into everything, but let's make it a little bit more elegant here by taking the difference of two squares, leaving us with the limit, which I'm going to denote as capital L, of, okay, difference of two squares is going to give us the first member squared, so cosine squared, and then negative sine squared times the cosine squared, and all of this with respect to phi, obviously. And now we are going to notice that we have cosine squared as a common factor, giving us limit as phi approaches 0 of, and now factoring out cosine squared, multiply it with, and what we're going to be left with is 1 minus the sine squared. Well, 1 minus the sine squared by the fundamental theorem of trigonometry is nothing but the cosine squared, which is kind of cool, leaving us with the cosine to the 4th power, so the limit as phi approaches 0 of cosine of phi, and all of this into big parentheses to the 4th power. And now we are going to notice that, well, polynomials of this kind, or exponentials in general, are also continuous, meaning we can track the limit to the inside. Cosine of 0 is going to evaluate to 1, 1 to the 4th power is going to turn into 1 in the limit. Yeah, and that's basically it. Now, for the last question, this is kind of an obvious one, in my opinion, but yeah, it's still kind of fun. So at first, let's try to see a certain pattern here. And this pattern actually has to do with factorials, because you might notice if we write out the prime factorization, for example, for 6, this is going to turn into, okay, 6 is nothing but 2 times 3. Now what about 24? I mean, 24 is nothing but 6 times 4, but 6 is nothing but 2 times 3, so 2 times 3 times 4. Now you might guess 120 is nothing but 5 times 24, so overall this right here is going to turn into 2 times 3 times 4 times 5. Multiplying this by 1, which doesn't change anything, is going to turn into 5 factorial. Same spiel here, this part right here is going to give us 4 factorial, then we are going to have 3 factorial, and 2 is nothing but 2 factorial. Meaning, what we are having here is an alternating series of the kind 1 over, well, our running index factorial. So this right here is hence nothing but, okay, we are going to have an infinite series where k starts at 2 in our case, k being greater or equal to 2, of nothing but, okay, we are having something over factorial all the time on each and every iteration, but also our signs are alternating, positive, negative, and so on. Now, I mean, to get an alternating series, we need -1 to the something power, but what is the something power? I mean, to the kth power does do the trick, because we are going to start at 2, -1 squared is going to give us positive, -1 to the third power is going to give us negative, and so on. So this works out. And now, this should definitely ring a bell for you, because this right here is extremely famous. This is basically just a Taylor series expansion of the exponential function of some sort. Just going to write it out for you. E to the x can be defined, this is one of its many definitions, as the infinite series where k is greater or equal to 0 of x to the kth power over k factorial. Now you might ask yourself, well, Papa, I mean, it kind of works, because if we were to put -1 into here, we are just going to get e to the negative x out. But thing is, this infinite series, or e to the -1 in our case, okay, but this infinite series starts at 0. And this infinite series starts at 2. I mean, there's a mistake here, right? Maybe not. Let's see what happens to the first two terms. So for k being equal to 0 and for k being equal to 1. What is going to happen overall? I mean, if we plug 0 into here, we are going to get, okay, negative 1 to the 0th power is 1, divided by, okay, 0 factorial. 0 factorial by definition, for example, one of definitions here, it's going to turn into 1. So 1 over 1 is nothing but 1. What about k being equal to 1? I mean, we're going to get negative 1 to the first power, which is negative 1, divided by 1 factorial, which is 1 by definition. Okay, negative 1 over 1 is going to turn into negative 1. Ah, this is good, right? I mean, if we add up those two members, so the first two, we are going to get 0, and adding 0 to an infinite series, which converges absolutely, is going to change nothing overall. Meaning, this right here is also equivalent to saying we are going to have the infinite series where k is greater or equal to 0 of negative 1 to the kth power over k factorial, which is by this definition exactly 1 over e. 1 over e overall. Yeah, and this basically concludes the 4 questions, and I hope you got everything correct. If you did like what you saw today, then you're definitely also going to enjoy today's sponsor brand, who are kind enough to sponsor yet another video here on this channel. What I enjoy the most about Brilliant is the interactive learning experience, which makes this website really unique for me, and maybe also for you if you decide to try it out for yourself. With their nearly 70 interactive courses in all topics STEM, be it mathematics, so calculus, linear algebra, etc., physics, chemistry, computer science, for example, they are going to prepare you for everything that you are basically going to need during your high school studies and your undergrad studies, and regarding, for example, quantum mechanics, also during your graduate studies, at least to some extent. And this is what I really enjoy the most about Brilliant. They give you this interactive learning experience, which is pretty unique to their website only. I haven't seen something like this on other websites up until now. And yeah, you can drag stuff around. They really give a purpose to those problems that are going to be presented to you, which I do find very enjoyable, actually. Not trying to play engineer here, but it's actually really useful to know when you can apply those problems in your real life too. For example, exponential function. How does this make any sense? Why would you need this in any real life situation? Oh, corona spreading, for example. And this is just pretty cool, and Brilliant offers this opportunity to you. And if you feel like trying it out for yourself, then make sure to check out the link at the top of the description. With it, you can try a big portion of Brilliant for free already, and the first 100 people to actually use the link get 20% off an annual premium subscription, which is a great deal considering how much content they have available on their website already. So definitely make sure to check it out and try to support the channel this way. If you enjoyed this video, then please like, subscribe, and recommend channel flag. Don't forget to also check out Flamble Maths too. We got a lot of calculus content going on over there, and I'm about to take a look at completing the square and vertex form of quadratic equations, etc. So it's getting quite good over there. Yeah, and up until next video, I wish you guys a flammable day. Ciao!